Good morning. It's good to have you join us via video this morning, and trust that you will enjoy the morning of worship as we focus upon the Lord. I will be reading from Psalm 46 in just a moment, but I want to share a little bit with you from my heart, because I am concerned about you, concerned about where you are spiritually and what's been happening during the last 6 to 7 weeks that we have been in our homes in Wisconsin, at least, and for the spiritual life that you are living. I am concerned about your walk with God. I've been praying for you. We'll continue to do that. And if you need to talk to someone, please feel free to give me a call. Pray that not only would you give me a call, but a text or an email. Would love to hear from you. Thank you for praying for us as we continue to serve the Lord in West Dallas. And thank you for you praying for Mark as he comes this morning and is going to share with us. And it's good to have Anthony back with us as he leads us in worship in just a few moments. I'm going to be reading from the book of Psalm, chapter 46. God is our refuge and strength, a very present help in trouble. Therefore, we will not fear. Though the earth gives way, though the mountains be moved into the heart of the sea, though its waters roar in foam, though the mountains tremble at its swelling. There is a river whose streams make glad the city of God, the holy habitation of the Most High. God is in the midst of her. She shall not be moved. God will help her when morning dawns. I'm so glad that our God is available, that he is always there for us in the midst of trouble and trial. Verse 6 says, the nations rage, the kingdoms totter. He utters his voice, the earth melts. The Lord of hosts is with us, and the God of Jacob is our fortress. Come, behold the works of the Lord, how he has brought desolations on the earth. He makes the wars to cease to the end of the earth. He breaks the bow and shatters the spear. He burns the chariots with fire. Be still and know that I am God. I will be exalted among the nations. I will be exalted in the earth. The Lord of hosts is with us. The God of Jacob is our fortress. I trust that you will take these words, and especially verse 10, be still and know that I am God. Let us go before the Lord this morning and pray and ask God to just really speak to our hearts. Heavenly Father, we thank you for the Lord Jesus Christ, that he came to earth nearly 2,000 years ago to die on a cross, to shed his blood for our sins. And God, this morning we want to come before you humbly. We want to exalt the Savior. We want to exalt our Creator and God, the Sustainer of life. Father, we thank you for each day that comes into our life, that we can come to you in prayer. We can come to you as we read the Word of God and ask you to speak to our hearts. God, I pray for each Christian out there that is listening right now, that you might allow each of them to listen to your voice through the Word, that they might take time to study, to pray, to take time to draw close to you in intimacy. Lord, we pray that you would just be with us as we get into the Word of God, as we worship you in song. May you speak to hearts, touch our lives, help us to worship you in spirit and in truth. And may Jesus Christ, our Savior, be exalted and glorified. We ask God for our world, that you might speak to those who are unsaved, that some may come and turn to the Savior in these difficult times. Minister and glorify yourself in the world. And we'll give you the praise in Christ's name. Amen.
The love of God is greater far than tongue or pen can ever tell. It goes beyond the highest star and reaches to the lowest hell. The guilty pair bow down with care. God gave his son to win. His erring child he reconciled and pardoned from his sin. Oh, love of God, how rich and pure, how measureless and strong. It shall forevermore endure the saints and angels' song. When hoary time shall pass away, and earthly thrones and kingdoms fall, when men who hear refuse to pray, on rocks and hills and mountains call, God's love so sure shall still endure, all measureless and strong. Redeeming grace to Adam's race, the saints and angels' song. Oh, love of God, how rich and pure, how measureless and strong. It shall forevermore endure the saints and angels' song. Could we within the ocean fill, and were the skies of parchment made, where every stalk on earth a quill, and every man a scribe by trade, to write the love of God above would drain the ocean dry, nor could the scroll contain the whole, though stretched from sky to sky. Oh, love of God, how rich and pure, how measureless and strong. It shall forevermore endure the saints and angels' song. Oh, love of God, how rich and pure, how measureless and strong. It shall forevermore endure the saints and angels' song. Amazing grace, How sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I'm found. Was blind, but now I see. 'Twas grace that taught my heart to fear, and grace my fears relieved. How precious did that grace appear the hour I first believed. My chains are gone, I've been set free. My God, my Savior has ransomed me. And like a flood, His mercy rains. Unending love, amazing grace. The Lord has promised good to me. His word, my hope, secures. He will my shield and portion be. As long as life endures, my chains are gone, I've been set free. My God, my Savior has ransomed me. And like a flood, His mercy rains. Unending love, amazing grace. My chains are gone, I've been set free. My God, my Savior has ransomed me. And like a flood, His mercy rains. Unending love, amazing grace. The earth shall soon dissolve like snow. The sun forbear to shine. But God, who called me here below, will be forever mine. Will be forever mine. You are forever mine. In Christ alone, my hope is found. He is my light, my strength, my song. This cornerstone this solid ground, firm through the fiercest drought and storm. What heights of love, what depths of peace, when fears are stilled, when striving cease. My comforter, my all in all, here in the love of Christ I stand. In Christ alone, who took on flesh, fullness of God in helpless babe, this gift of love and righteousness, scorned by the ones he came to save, till on that cross as Jesus died, the wrath of God was satisfied. For every sin on him was laid, here in the death of Christ I live. There in the ground his body lay, a light of the world by darkness slain. Then bursting forth in glorious day, up from the grave he rose again. And as he stands in victory, since curse has lost its grip on me, for I am his and he is mine, bought with the precious blood of Christ. No guilt in life, no fear in death, this is the power of Christ in me. From life's first cry to final breath, Jesus commands my destiny. No power of hell, no scheme of man, can never pluck me from his hand. Till he returns or calls me home, here in the power of Christ I'll stand. No power of hell, no scheme of man, can ever pluck me from his hand. Till he returns or calls me home, here in the power of Christ I'll stand.
Thank you, Anthony. What a blessing it is to have you here these past 2 weeks to be able to lead us in worship for our Lord God Almighty. We're here today to celebrate Mother's Day, and I hope you all have worked out your plans and what you're going to do for your day, whether it be takeout or at home or a home-cooked meal or whatever, but I hope that you have reflected upon the last year of what your mother has done for you, and let her know what her value is to you. Let's open with a word of prayer. Father God, I want to thank you for your grace and your mercy. I want to thank you for the word of God and the strength that it gives to us. Father, I want to thank you for the trials that you put us through to sanctify us, to mature us, to bring us to what you want us to be, more in the image of Christ. Father, as you listen to the service today, I just pray that this message would touch the hearts of those that need to hear it. I pray that you keep me slow in speech, but firm in my conviction of what we're saying here. I thank you again for all that you do for us, what you blessed with, even my own mother. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Today we're going to be looking at two godly mothers, but I got a couple stories I wanted to share with you. I had picked out one a little serious, one a little funny, but just examples of mothers that we have. Years ago, a young mother was making her way across the hills of South Wales, and she was carrying her baby with her. And a blizzard came upon her and it overtook her, and she wasn't able to make it to her destination. And so after the storm subsided, the people who were going out looking for her to try to find out what happened, they found her underneath a mound of snow, and what they realized, though, is that the mother had taken all of her outer clothing off because she was carrying her baby, and she wrapped up her baby with all the clothing and then covered herself over the top of her, or top of the baby, and the baby survived. Years later, as this child grew up, his name is David Lloyd George, and when he became a full adult, he became Prime Minister of Great Britain, and without doubt, one of England's greatest statesmen. I think from that, just knowing what his mother did for him and the sacrifice she gave him the conviction as well to live out his duties as the Minister of Great Britain in the same passion. So I think that really just affected him and how that, what his mother has done for him. Quite the story. I mean, I don't know if I would have the conviction myself if I to do that, but I hope and pray that I would. The next one is Remembering Mom. It says, a teacher gave her class of second graders a lesson on the magnet and what it does and how it picks things up. And the next day she gave them a test on this to see what they could remember. And the question was, my name has six letters. The first one is M. I pick things up. What am I? So she collected all the papers back and looked at all the answers for the test, and over 50% of the answers, the question was answered with the word mother. So I think there's a lot of mothers out there that leave a great impact on what they're doing with their children. But I chose the book of Ruth today because I felt that there's good examples in here for what a mother should be, or a godly mother. And I'm going to be drawing from the first chapter of today's message, or for today's message. So let's get some background of this account in Ruth chapter 1, verses 1 through 5. Excuse me. It says, in the days when the judges ruled, there was a famine in the land, and a man of Bethlehem in Judah went to sojourn in the country of Moab, he and his wife and his two sons. The name of the man was Elimelech, and the name of his wife was Naomi. And the names of his two sons were Mahlon and Chilion. They were Ephrathites from Bethlehem in Judah, and they went into the country of Moab and remained there. But Elimelech, the husband of Naomi, died and was left with her two sons. These took Moabite wives. The name of the one was Orpah, and the name of the other Ruth. They lived there about 10 years, and both Mahlon and Chilion died, so that the woman was left without her two sons and her husband. So as we look at this in the first verse, it says, in the days when the judges ruled, there was a famine in the land, and the man of Bethlehem went to sojourn in the country of Moab. Well, in the days when the judges ruled, that tells you, gives you a description of what's going on right now in Judah. And if you look over to Judah, the last book, it's a page over for me, but chapter 21, verse 25, it says, in those days there was no king in Israel. Everyone did what was right in his own eyes. So there's a lot of individuals not following the Lord. They were just doing what they felt was worthy of their own. And so here's Elimelech. He's got a famine going on, and he possibly decides to take his family out of Bethlehem and go over to Moab to look for better or greener pastures. I think that he probably had a conversation with his wife, Naomi, and said, "Hey, this is not working out so well here right now. We're under judgment, possibly, this, you know, with this famine from God. I'd like to take our family over and see if we can make it work in Moab." Naomi possibly disagreed. She might have agreed, but she still was submissive as far as we see here that they left together as a family and went to Moab. We look at the name of Elimelech. That means God is my king. We look at Naomi. Her name means pleasantness or pleasant. The names of the son, Mahlon and Chilion. Mahlon means unhealthy and Chilion means puny. The reason why I just simply say these names is just to kind of give a description of what the family is like as far as maybe they give some description, because I know back when Jews gave out names, they kind of described the person or what they were or who their personality. I don't know if I would have really cared for Mahlon or Chilion, though, being called unhealthy or puny, though. I mean, that's maybe, you know, Chilion was a preemie, I don't know, but to be called puny your whole life, that's kind of a... I don't know. It's just something I don't have to deal with now, but it would be interesting. But they were Ephrathites from Bethlehem in Judah. Let's not pass over this real quick. Let's take a peek at this. Ephrathites from Bethlehem in Judah. Why is that stuck in here? Well, in this is, leads to the genealogy of Christ. This leads to the connection between the house of David and the tribe of Judah. Without this book, we really wouldn't have that, so you would have a disconnect somewhere in the line of Christ, in his genealogy. If you go to, hold on a second, let me get my notes here. Micah 5:2. It says, "But you, O Bethlehem Ephrathah, who are too little to be among the class of Judah, the clans of Judah, from you shall come forth for me one who is to be ruler in Israel, whose coming forth is from of old, from ancient of days." So I think that's stuck in here as far as the writer's going, where it's part of just identifying the lineage. So also, if you look at the name of Bethlehem, Bethlehem also means a house of bread, and Judah means praise. So here, Elimelech is going from the house of bread and the house of praise to Moab. Well, what does Moab mean? Well, if we go to Psalm 108:9, it actually says that it's God's wash basin, which is kind of an interesting analogy or kind of description of what Moab is. If you look at it, another way to kind of describe that would be it's God's garbage can. So here is the time of Judges where people are doing whatever they want in their own eyes. And then Elimelech has taken his family out of the house of bread and the land of praise to the garbage can. When we try to do under our own understanding of what, even though God is having us under judgment, if we try to take it and do it on our own strength, possibly, how does that always turn out? Do we always look to the right ways to resolve our issue instead of letting God just put us through the trial and refine us and to... make us more in his image? It's something that's possibly, I wouldn't say exactly he did say that. It obviously doesn't clearly state why, but it's just something I'm thinking about where if you looking at what's going on, maybe he was doing this himself. Maybe this is what he was reasoning out himself to try to say, well, if God is putting us through his judgment, I'm going to just try to do this on my own. So, well, let's see how this kind of turns out. So in verse 3 it says, "But Elimelech, the husband of Naomi, died, and she was left with her two sons. And these took Moabite wives. The name of one was Orpah, and the name of the other was Ruth." So over, we don't know how long, setting up a farm there, trying to raise crops, make a living there, Elimelech dies, and then his two sons take on wives. And Orpah, her name means like dawn, or I'm sorry, fawn or deer, which is basically kind of an analogy for being athletic. And then Ruth means beautiful. But it doesn't just mean beautiful in the sense of like just her looks. It's also in her intellect. Like she has what J. Vernon McGee put it in his commentary, it means like glamorous, like she just has an all-around package. And so from there, they both obviously live about 10 more years, then Malin and Chilean died, so that the woman was left with her two sons and her husband. So that's the background we're kind of looking at right now, where there's three women in the land of Moab, trying to make ends meet, trying to live it out, and that's what's going on from there. So the focus today is to let us examine these two women that become godly examples of motherhood. And the first woman I'd like to look at is Naomi, the spiritually submissive wife. I'm going to read verses 6 through 10. It says, "Then she arose with her daughter-in-laws to return from the country of Moab, for she had heard in the fields of Moab that the Lord had visited his people and given them food. So she set out from the place where she was with her two daughters-in-laws, and they went on the way to return to the land of Judah. But Naomi said to her two daughters-in-laws, 'Go, return each of you to your mother's house. May the Lord deal kindly with you as you have dealt with the dead and with me. The Lord grant that you may find rest, each of you, in the house of her husband.' Then she kissed them, and they lifted up their voices and wept." So after being there without her husband and her two sons, they're out in the fields. They're still trying to produce their farming, to do their crops, possibly making their living. And while she's out there, she hears that back in Bethlehem that the Lord has provided food for them. So she decides to return from Moab back to Bethlehem. And as she's doing this, she's thinking ahead of what's going on, possibly with the judgment, possibly with losing her husband, what's happening, why is she just, you know, with her daughter-in-laws. But she sits there and thinks about her daughters, what's going on, and she explains to them, as they're going back to the Bethlehem, "Go return each of you to your mother's house, and may the Lord deal kindly with you as you have dealt with the dead and with me." So she's still looking to the Lord. She still understands that the Lord is still in charge, that the Lord can provide for them. So in that verse, the word kindly, it's a Hebrew word that means to have a loyal connection. It's the word hesed. So it's not just an act of kindness. There's actually a connection between the two of them where there is a commitment given on both sides to voluntarily love each other. It's not just a one-way thing. It's not just an act of kindness that just goes one way. So for the last 10 years, between the three of them, Orpah and Ruth have stayed loyal to Naomi. They haven't just left and gone about their own way. And I think in those last 10 years of just living together with her as well, I think Naomi had quite an influence on those two as far as who God is and like his commands and his love, as we'll find out a little here later on. So while still in her grief, she still is thinking of the Lord. She still knows that the Lord is in control. And she's thinking ahead to her daughter-in-laws about, "You're still young women, you know, just go back home and may you find rest with new husbands, with the protection and provision from other men." Because the time that they live in, widows and single women had it pretty rough because the men weren't there to provide for them. But as we see also, verse 10, it says, "No, we will return with you to your people." So I'm going to go through 11 through 14 now. It says, "But Naomi said, 'Turn back, my daughters. Why will you go with me? Have I yet sons in my womb that they may become your husbands? Turn back, my daughters. Go your way. For I am too old to have a husband. If I should say I have hope, even if I should have a husband this night and should bear sons, Would you therefore wait till they were grown? Would you therefore refrain from marrying? No, my daughters, for it is exceedingly bitter to me for your sake that the hand of the Lord has gone out against me. Then they lifted up their voices and wept again. And Orpah kissed her mother-in-law, but Ruth clung to her. So what's going on here is after the first time that Ruth and Orpah said, no, we'll still go with you, Naomi is wanting to explain it further. She wants to get into more detail of why she is saying return to your mothers. Why return to your own land? Why return to your own people? And what she's talking about in this whole context as well is the law in Deuteronomy 25:5. And it states that if brothers dwell together and one of them dies and has no son, the wife of the dead man shall not be married outside of the family to another, to a stranger. Her husband's brother shall go into her and take her as his wife and perform the duty of a husband's brother to her. So they're not supposed to marry outside the family. If they were to return with Naomi to Bethlehem, they would possibly remain widows. They would have no children. And so Naomi is trying to impress this upon him and say, look, this is what's going on. You know, when I go back, I'm going to be submissive to the Lord God Almighty. I'm not going to live outside of his commands because look what has happened already. I've lost my husband. I lost my sons. I'm going back. You know, there's food now in Bethlehem. So I'm going to stick to what I know I'm supposed to, and that's to be submissive to God. And so if you guys come back with me, you might not be able to marry. You won't have children. And also there's a judgment on here. The last part of it here, it says that in verse 13, it says, no, my daughters, for it is exceedingly bitter to me for your sake that the hand of the Lord has gone out against me. That exceedingly bitter, it's a very high extent of unpleasantness as far as, like, you know, look at my life, look at what's happened. I don't have my husband and I don't have any sons. Even if I were to marry right now and have children, would you wait however many years for me to be able to provide that for you according to our laws and statutes in Judah for God? And so I think Naomi wanted to make sure that they understood what it meant to go back to Bethlehem. They wanted her to know, she wanted them to know that, hey, you know, are you willing to do this? And as we see here, Orpah kisses her mother-in-law to go back to her people, but Ruth clings to her. I think that Naomi, as we're looking here, she loves her daughter-in-law. She's not like she's wanting to get rid of them just because she doesn't want to be around them anymore, but I think she's really taking a stance of like, I'm going to be committed to the Lord, and I'm going to do what is required of me, even though I have a judgment upon me, even though my family is no longer with me per se, but I'm going to go back to Bethlehem for the food that I'm hearing that is being provided, and possibly have the ability to have help from my family as well, for those who are still there. And so I think she has great concern by telling this to her daughter-in-laws. So now we have Leland Wang, who remembers his mother. He's a Chinese evangelist who, when he was very young, was being very naughty towards his mother. And the mother was using a stick to discipline him. But he was too quick, and she couldn't keep up with him. And so he ran off, actually taunting her, like, aha, you can't catch me. And so what she did instead of trying to chase him down, though, she stood very still, and she said this very thing. She said, I feel ashamed of myself that I have brought up a boy who is not willing to be disciplined by his mother when he does wrong, so I must punish myself. And she began to whip her bare arm. And Leland, this touched his heart so much that he actually ran back to his mother, threw his arms around her and asked her to stop punishing herself, but actually to punish him because of what was going on, because she was taking the punishment for him. Says that Mr. Wang, that as he grew older, the memory of this incident helped him to understand that the great love of Jesus Christ willingly took our place on the cross. So how does that tie in with Naomi? I think that Naomi also, because of what she saw, the judgment going on, she was also trying to warn her daughter-in-law, like, look, this is the punishment that possibly is coming down that you'll have to bear with me if you come with me. And as we saw, that Orpah kissed her mother-in-law, but Ruth clung to her. In 2 Corinthians 5, 14 and 15, for the love of Christ controls us, because we have concluded this, that one has died for all, therefore all have died, that we might no longer live for themselves or for ourselves, but for him who for the sake died and was raised. So as we look at the whole situation with Naomi and her family, what's happened, can you look to your own and say, as far as, are you submitted to Christ, even under the circumstances that you are living? As we as parents, are we living for Jesus Christ as well? May we be thankful for our mothers and remind them today of just all the stuff, the trials that we've gone through with them and how they've submitted to God and shown us how to be more mature. May we let them know that. So our first mother, Ruth, is Naomi, who shows us spiritual submissiveness. But again, as we look at Orpah kissed her mother-in-law goodbye, but Ruth clung to her. So the second woman I want to talk about is Ruth, the spiritually determined woman. Starting in verse 15. And she said, see, your sister-in-law has gone back to her people and to her gods. Return after your sister-in-law. But Ruth said, do not urge me to leave you or to return from following you. For where you go, I will go, and where you lodge, I will lodge. Your people shall be my people, and your God my God. Where you die, I will die, and there will I be buried. May the Lord do so to me and more also, if anything but death parts me from you. And when Naomi saw that she was determined to go with her, she said no more. So in verse 15, Naomi is trying one more time to convince Ruth not to follow her. She's trying to use Orpah as an example of what she's, you know, to return with her, to say, look, your sister-in-law is making the right choice. You need to return with her. Go to her people and your gods. Go back to Moab yourself. Don't come with me. But in verses 16 through 18, Ruth isn't having it, though. Ruth has determination and resolve to follow Naomi. And I don't believe it's just because of Naomi, even though they have a strong love, a strong connection together. In verse 16 it says, but Ruth said, do not urge me to leave you or to return from following you, for where you go, I will go, and where you lodge, I will lodge. Do not urge me to leave you. He says, Ruth has already made up her mind before they even came to this point. I think well before this, because it's not something you just say lightly that all of a sudden you're leaving, you're going to be packing up and walking away, and then during that time that Naomi decides Ruth decides to stay with Naomi. I think that during this whole time, in those 10 years that she was with Naomi, she began to see and understand who God was. I believe that she was convinced her old life was not right, that was improper. And through those 10 years of hard work, you know, working out in the fields and trying to provide for themselves, I think there was a great bond that was created with that, not only with Naomi, but with God herself. And I think somewhere along those lines, she possibly made a commitment of faith, and she's actually declaring it here as we continue. It says, where you go, I will go, and where you lodge, I will lodge. Ruth is willing to accept her impoverished position with Naomi. Wherever they end up, whatever situation they're going to deal with, Ruth is telling Naomi, I'm not going to leave. I'm going to stay here. I'm going to be with you no matter what. Doesn't matter what kind of situation we're stuck in. Again, she's in a world where widows and single women have it very hard without a husband. So knowing what Naomi told her about how she possibly won't be married, about how possibly she won't have children, there's a judgment upon me and my family as far as from what has happened possibly with, you know, my husband and my son's dying. Are you willing to deal with that? And Naomi's like, yeah, or Ruth is like, yes, I'm willing to deal with it. I'm willing to identify with you. Your people shall be my people. Ruth is willing to cast off her nationality, her own people, her own way of life, to pick up the customs of the Jewish people. She is willing to be considered possibly an outcast with Naomi. She's a foreigner. The Moabites and the Israelites do not really mix. They don't really intermingle with each other. They have totally different cultures, different ways of living, and obviously different gods. They have pagan gods. Israel has the real God. And it says, and your God shall be my God. And this is where I think she's actually stating to Naomi very firmly that a decision of faith, an outspoken one. She's wanted to be under the care of God. Again, it's not just for Naomi. It's also because she does not want to leave the Lord God Almighty. All her life, she's lived in her country, and she knows what it's like. She knows the culture, the pagans, the gods, and all that kind of stuff. But here came a family out of Bethlehem, out of the house of bread, into the trash can, so to speak. And now she's learned of who God is and who the real and how that's brought her joy and understanding, possibly. So she's really wanting to identify with that. She really wants to have the determination, so much so that she's willing to take on all of these things that Naomi says, this might possibly be your life. I don't know about you, but even just reading this myself and digging into this chapter in the book of Ruth, it really has made me reflect upon myself as well as far as the convictions that I have about what am I willing to sacrifice, what am I willing to step out and declare more so than I already have. Not only just to me, but then for my wife and my family. What convictions will I have when tragedy strikes or when hardship comes? And it says in 17, it says, where you die, I will die, and there will I be buried. I took this from J. Vernon McGee's commentary, but it says that Ruth is saying that she believes in the hope that the Israelites believe in, that they will have, or they will live in the promised land when they are resurrected. So I think she's making a commitment of like, I have the same hope that you have. I have the same hope that when Christ comes back, that I will be resurrected and I will be in the land of Israel. And then at the end here it says, may the Lord do so to me and more also, if anything but death parts me from you. She's telling Naomi this is a lifelong commitment. That she's not doing this just to come out there just because there's food in Israel, in Judah. She's coming out there because she has a real commitment, that she has a desire to be with the Lord and with Naomi. She's still, this is not just something she's coming to lightly. She's saying this is going to be till the end. And so I think she's declaring this to Naomi right now as the situation goes, because she does not want to be parted from her. She's denying her past and looking towards her future with determination. She's weighing this out well before they got to this point. Because again, who makes that kind of a decision right on the spot? I mean, you can cry tears and make it look good, but do you actually have the conviction to live behind it? And we're actually, as the rest of the book goes, you'll find this out of what her real, how her actions live out what she's declaring. She doesn't even want to possibly have the possibility of having the help of her parents if they're still alive. She could go back to Moab and say, hey, my husband died, my mother-in-law has left, I'm kind of starting over, can I get some assistance? And I think she's also saying no to that as well. So she's standing on a conviction. She's standing on her convictions. She's taking an open-eyed leap of faith, trusting in nothing more than a knowledge of what she knows of God and Naomi in her situation. Sometimes with this, I think that because there is nothing, because they don't have much, it makes that kind of a choice easier to see, easier to understand as far as the importance of it, what really matters. I think having too many things in life, even with this whole coronavirus lockdown and people not being able to do as much as they're able to. I mean, look how, I don't know about you individually, but for myself and others I've talked to, a lot of things have come into focus as far as what is important and what is not, what you can live without and what you can't live without. And I think Ruth has experienced that in these past 10 years of what's going on between with her and Naomi and Orpah at the time. So sometimes you do have to have nothing to make that decision. Sometimes you do have to have a tragedy or some kind of trial to be able to say what really matters, what really is beneficial. Again, studying the Word of God and looking at it, you really begin to see what matters and what doesn't. If you just sit there and look at every other these philosophies that are going out there, I can see why it can be confusing and why you would have trouble having hope or having security or having the understanding that, you know, what to believe. What do I look at that says this is truth, this is going to be okay, or this gives me hope? But the Word of God is solid. The Word of God is the only thing that you need. It's the only authority that we should have. So Ruth and Naomi are heading back to Bethlehem. Ruth has made a declaration of her desire to be not only with Naomi, but with God and under his care. And Orpah chose to go back to her God. She didn't want to take that big of a sacrifice, that big of a risk. And so here we have Naomi, who's submissive, who after 10 years plus kept God at the forefront of all that has happened. And now we have Ruth, who is determined to live out that life with Naomi, with the Lord God. Eric Little. I don't know if everybody knows who Eric Little is. I'm sure from 40 on up, I think roughly age-wise might know who Eric Little is, but maybe my son doesn't. I don't know. Anthony, do you know who that is? No? Okay. So I'm close. It's around 40s. But this gentleman was born in China to his missionary parents from Scotland. He was known as the Flying Dutchman because he was the fastest sprinter in Scotland at the time. But due to his convictions and belief in God, he refused to run any event on a Sunday. Absolutely none. Didn't matter what it was. Well, here comes the Olympics of 1924, and the 100-meter race, his most favored and his best event, landed on a Sunday, but he refused to run it. He stuck by his convictions. I know in the movie Chariots of Fire, which is the movie's based on this, Eric Little, it shows that he actually didn't find out till like as he was going to the Olympics that that's when the event was scheduled, but it was actually months in advance if you look at the actual true research that he knew well before the Olympics even came that he still made that choice and to not run the 100 meters. I also know that in the movie that they show that one where he falls down and everybody passes him, he gets up and it runs and beats everybody. That's also not the Olympics. That was a different event, but that you can do your own research and find out which one that was. But it did happen, but not in the movie as it was portrayed. But he lived by his convictions. He wouldn't let anything get in the way, even his most favorite thing, which was running in a 100-meter race, stand in the way of him saying, no, I'm going to give this day to the Lord. Give this day to the Lord. One of his most famous quotes is, I believe God made me for a purpose, but he also made me fast. By a fellow missionary that was working with him in China, he says his last words were, it's complete surrender. And he was referring to how he gave his life to the Lord. As we go through our own lives and we look at what's going on, and how often do we run without regard? How often do we simply say complete surrender to the Lord? Even for Naomi, and the opportunity as far as like what she had to deal with, and still kept God at the forefront. Yeah, she was bitter about it. She didn't like what was happening, but she still said, Lord, you are my Lord. And Ruth was determined also to live out that kind of lifestyle under God's care and accept him by faith. So what is your purpose in life? Are you completely surrendered to your convictions, or are you willing to pay the price for your convictions? Do we really take what we say seriously, even on an oath for marriage? Or are they just words that come out? I truly think that as we learn more about the Word of God and we see his love for us and what he sacrificed, that the gap that he had that we have to cross, or he crossed for us, just becomes that much greater. The love of the Lord becomes that much deeper, that much more abounding, meaningful. And I think that also helps us to understand why we praise the Lord, of why, how grateful we are for the Lord and what he's done for us. So is our foundation upon the Word of God? Are we giving our life sacrificially to the Lord? I started out with the illustration of the mother who sacrificed her life for her son. And we look at it and say, you know, did she possibly have the thought, what if they don't find my baby? What if I do this for nothing? But I can say, I believe myself, that I believe without a doubt that she actually, because of her actions, that she did this because she loved her son, is what I'm trying to say. And I think that's the same what the Lord did for us. I think because by his own actions, about what he's done for us. Not to say that we can't believe the word of God, but I just think also it just puts emphasis on that. He is behind everything he says. We can have faith in who God is. So may God's word sanctify us, strengthen us, and comfort us as we live for him. So I kind of put down this last paragraph. It says, we have a Lord God, an almighty God, who sent his son while loving us first in our wretchedness, determined to do what he knew was the only way to save us, and that was just through his son, Jesus. He will put us through the trials to sanctify us. He gives us his word to strengthen us, and he will bless us with a joy to comfort us because he loves us. Sounds like a lot like a foundation of a godly mother. Do you know him? And does he know you? Let's pray. Father God, I just want to thank you for your grace and your patience, and I want to thank you for your word of God. Father, I ask that you fulfill every resolve for good and every act of faith with your power. Father, may we seek your spiritual wisdom and understanding for all endurance and patience with joy. Father, I want to say thank you for making such a position as a mother, a godly mother, for all that she does and how she loves her children, whether she's lost them or not, just like Naomi. But may we all stick to our convictions. May we all live out loving you, Lord, and seek your face. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Pastor Les would like to say something before the... Oh, cancel that thought. Change your plans. So have a great Mother's Day. I thank you for taking the time to listen to this. I hope it was beneficial, that the Lord has spoken to you. And God bless.